Okay, so we're going to start off by talking about concavity and the second derivative test. I probably should have raised this before I started this. So remember when we talked about first derivative, what did taking the first derivative, what was the first derivative test? What did that give us? I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you. I was deafened by the sound of this thing. Not secant. It gave us the slope of the tangent line, which told us whether the function was increasing or decreasing. Okay? So now we're going to talk about the second derivative test. So this is going to give us concavity. So we want to determine the intervals on which a function is concave up or concave down. So concave up means bowl-shaped, like we're holding water. And concave down is bowl-shaped where we're dumping the water out, right? We want to find any points of inflection on a graph. And a point of inflection is just where we switch over from concave up to concave down. So if we're going concave up, oh, we switch over to concave down, that spot where we switch is called a point of inflection. And then we want to apply the second derivative test to find relative extrema of a function. So we can do relative extrema with the second derivative test as well, okay? So, concavity. So we've seen that locating the intervals in which a function increases or decreases helps to describe its graph. We can tell what it's doing, where it's going up, where it's going down. So in this section, we're going to see how locating the intervals where the function increases or decreases can be used to determine where the graph is curving up or down. Okay, not just increasing or decreasing, but where it's curving. And that's what concavity is. So the definition of concavity is given by this nice thing here. If f is differentiable on an open interval, well, we're going to let f be differentiable. The graph of f is concave upward when the first derivative is increasing on the interval and concave downward when the first derivative is decreasing on the interval. Okay? So, following graphical representation shows us the function is differentiable on the interval I. Notice that it's nothing keeping us from differentiating this function, right? It's not got a hole in it. Its limits are all there. If the graph is concave upward on I, then the graph of F lies above all of its tangent lines on I. Let's see what that. If the graph of F is concave upward on I, then the graph of F lies above all of the tangent lines on I. So what it's saying is that all of the tangent lines have to be below, or else you can see the picture. For it to be concave up, you know, all of the tangent lines have to be below graphically. It's a way of picturing it that we can see. Okay. If we were having something concave down, then the tangent line would be above the graph. So we can see graphically that this is always going to be the case, as we can see here. So obviously this is concave down since all of the tangent lines are above the graph. Okay. This is not anything that you can't just see, right? I mean, you can tell whether a bowl is upside down or not, okay? Now, to find open intervals on which the graph of a function is concave up or concave down, you need to find the intervals on which f prime is increasing or decreasing, okay? Now, what does that mean? Now, we use the first derivative test to determine whether a function is increasing, okay? So you've got a function. You want to know if it's increasing or not, you take the first derivative. If you want to determine whether the first derivative is increasing, what do you need to do? Take the second derivative, okay? That's where the second derivative test comes in. So if you've got a function, graph is 1/3 x cubed minus x, okay? We've got f prime as x squared minus 1. So notice that if you take this graph of 1/3 x cubed minus x, if you take its derivative, you get x squared minus 1, which is a parabola. And you notice that it's decreasing on this interval. Okay? See what I'm saying? So from here, it's decreasing. Here, it's increasing. From negative infinity to 0, though, it's decreasing. From here, you know, from arrow to 0, it's decreasing. Therefore, from here to here, that tells us that this is concave down. Okay? That's the graphical representation of it, and that's what we're looking at. Does that make sense? There are two things at work here. Now, I'm never going to ask you to look at a graph and say, okay, take this function, graph its first derivative, and then look at it and tell me what's going on. It's not, I mean, we don't do that. We just say, take this function, take its second derivative, and determine whether it's increasing or decreasing, and then tell me whether it's concave up or concave down. Okay? So we're just showing you graphically what's going on. Okay? Now, here is the actual theorem that we're going to apply. The test for concavity. If the second derivative is positive, then it's concave up. If the second derivative is negative, it's concave down. It's just that simple. There's no reason to graph anything. There's no reason to draw any pictures. It's just take the second derivative. If it's positive, it's concave up. If it's negative, it's concave down. Okay? Now, what we have to do is, much like the first derivative test, we still have to locate the x values where the second derivative is equal to 0 or doesn't exist. Just like we did with the first derivative test, right? We had to find the critical values. So, those are going to be the points that we use to do the test interval. Okay? These are not going to necessarily be the same points that we use to test for the first derivative test. A lot of times they will be, but they're not always going to be. Okay? So let's look at this. And we want to find the open intervals on which the graph is concave up or concave down. So, what's the first thing we want to do? We want to take this and differentiate it, right? So, what's the easiest way to do that? What's the easiest way to do it? Probably product rule, because this is a constant on the top. I'm not going to worry with it. I'll just rewrite it as 6 times x squared plus 3 to the negative 1. And I'm not even going to use product rule. I'm just going to use chain rule. Okay? So, I don't know why I wrote negative 1. F prime of x is going to be negative 6, x squared plus 3, decrease by 1, take the derivative of inside, gives us 2x. So that gives us negative 12x times x squared plus 3 to the negative 2. Now that's the first derivative. Right? Yes, negative, I'm sorry. Right. So, we got negative 12x times x squared plus 3 to the negative 2. So now we need to take the second derivative. Now this is going to be product rule. So first, times the derivative of the second. So negative 2, x squared plus 3 to the negative 3, times 2x, plus second, times the derivative of the first. So that's going to give us positive 24 times 2 is 48 x squared times x squared plus 3 to the negative third minus 12 x squared plus 3 to the negative 2.